You're now watching Wayback Wednesday, sponsored by Flora's Glass and Mirror Company, servicing the area since 1977 with residential and commercial work.
Rocky Mountain, and welcome to Wayback Wednesday. I'm your host, Randy Adcox. Glad you could join us on the broadcast tonight. Last week's show, we covered a bunch of ground, and we're going to go back and kind of overlap some of that with the night show from last week. But I got a couple, or at least one in particular, thank you I want to send out. We had a caller last week who called and made a reference to a connection between Kay Kaiser's family and the Carlton Noel, the Body Noel family. And Farley Phillips, who is one of our regular viewers, sent me a message via Facebook, and she had actually found an article online, I guess. And it turns out Kay Kaiser's daughter, Virginia Kaiser, married Walter Carlton Noel. And so that's where the connection was made between the Kaiser family and the Noel family. So thank you, Farley, for that. I believe it was Eric who called in and asked a question. So there you go, Eric. There's the answer to your question about how the relation came to be there. Had a caller also call in and ask about the Little General. And if you remember, we talked briefly about this, and the caller asked if anyone remembered a Civil War locomotive coming to Rocky Mount, and the name of the locomotive was the Little General. So I went in search of any information I could find about the Little General, and specifically about a visit here in Rocky Mount. What I uncovered was really interesting, to say the least, and I'm going to share some pictures with you tonight. Some are pretty good quality, some not so great, and I apologize. A lot of these come out of the newspaper, and by the time they get digitized and saved on a computer server somewhere and then get processed through and get to the public, the quality is just not that great. So again, I apologize. Some of these are a little grainy, some are kind of dark, not too clear. But there's a really neat story there about the Little General, and we'll get into that in a few minutes. But you know, as we so often talk about with this show, you just can't talk about the history of Rocky Mount and Eastern North Carolina without mentioning a handful of things that just have a common theme throughout the entire history of this region. Certainly, agriculture is a biggie with tobacco, corn, cotton, soybean, and so forth. Agriculture has just made this part of the state and certainly this part of the country. And then, of course, we've talked about the impact of the railroad, and certainly from the early 1800s, 1830s, 1840s, when the railroad first made its way into Rocky Mount, there's just been a tremendous impact on this area and certainly on Rocky Mount. You know, we're not as a big a venue now as we were in years past. I think the new CSX transmodal facility out here in Edgecombe County is going to be kind of a rebirth, if you will, of that kind of activity, certainly, and hopefully jobs and economic progress for the area. But for many, many years, the railroad was a backbone of employment for this area. And it's, you know, over the years, there's been cycles of employment and opportunities there. Not as much now as it was in years past, but there's a neat little story that I'll get into, and we'll talk a little bit about the history of trains in Rocky Mount. And this is a very brief overview. I certainly don't intend to cover the last 150 years or so of trains. So, but I know we've got some viewers who used to work for the railroad and are ex-employees. So feel free, any time of night, 407-1111 is the number you see on your screen there. Feel free to call. But we're going to talk a little bit about the railroad's impact in Rocky Mount in this area. And then we're going to get into the Little General, and I'll share with you what I found. And I'll tell you, I did not find a specific reference for the Little General itself, that actual train visiting Rocky Mount. Now, having said that, that does not mean it did not come here. I've mentioned several times over the last few weeks about the newspapers.com website that we're now using to help put together the content for this show. It's a phenomenal website. It's got literally thousands, tens of thousands of newspapers from all over the country, all over the world, in fact. And it's a great resource avenue to look up and find information about, got a myriad of topics. But I did. I searched high and low to try to find some reference of the little general itself coming to Rocky Mount. And though I'm sure it did, the only reference I found was a gentleman back in the 40s had a train collection, a toy train collection, and amongst his train collection was a model, a small model of the little general steam locomotive. And so, as I said, because I couldn't find a newspaper article on it or a picture of it in Rocky Mount does not mean it did not come here. So if anyone remembers going to see the little general steam locomotive when it came to Rocky Mount, please give us a call. We're interested, number one, in roughly what year time frame this was. It has been in the museum for the last, golly, 40, 50 years or more. But there was a time when it was on a traveling circuit, if you will. And I'll show you some pictures in a little bit of some of the stops it made along the way. So if anyone remembers seeing that little general locomotive, give us a call, 407-1111. Now, before we get into that, though, I just wanted to share some articles for you. And some of these are newspaper clippings. They're not actually pictures of things. They're just pictures of newspaper articles. And I saved them, and I'm sharing them with you because they tell a story not only about the little general, but about the impact of trains. And this first one is a great article that appeared in the Rocky Mount Telegram in March of 1965. And Lee, if you want to go ahead and put this up on the screen, I'm going to read some of it, not the whole thing, because it's a really fairly long article. But the headline says it all. Trains have chugged, zipped, and through the city for a century. And again, this was in 1965. I think the first trains hit here sometime around 1840, so it was actually over a century by the time this article came out. But this was written by a Sunday editor back in 1965 with the Rocky Mount Telegram named Mr. Ed Reiner. Some of you may remember Ed. Anyway, it says, the Atlantic Coast Line's railroad tracks through Rocky Mount's main streets bother some people because of traffic delays or the so-called ugliness of a train going right through the center of town. Old-timers remind us, however, that the train was here before Rocky Mount was. Locomotives have been chugging and diesels have been zipping through Rocky Mount almost a century. The hamlet of Rocky Mount, population 100, was incorporated around the railroad in 1867 when the line was the Wilmington Weldon Railroad. The line became the ACL in 1900. Wilmington Weldon's train started through Edgecombe County in 1840 when the 161.5-mile rail link between Weldon and Wilmington was completed. The railroad in 1840 consisted of 12 locomotives, 8 coaches, 4 post office cars, 50 freight cars, and 4 steamers in 1840. One of the early engines built for Wilmington Weldon was the S.D. Wallace. This was about 1866. And Lee, if you would, let's go to the next picture. And here we have a picture of the S.D. Wallace locomotive from 1866. And again, I apologize. These pictures that come from the newspaper, a little grainy, a little dark, hard to see a lot of detail in them. But in any case, in 1866, this locomotive made its way through here on the Wilmington-Weldon route. So after World War I, ACL began thinking of speed and power for its steam locomotives. About 1920, 2 series of locomotives began north-south runs through town. And Lee, the next picture shows us the 1200 series, I'm sorry, the 1500 series, this next picture. And this is actually, well, let me back up a minute. I got ahead of myself. This is 1919. This is actually, my page is out of nowhere. This is a passenger train car from 1919. And again, it's the picture's not very good quality. I do apologize. But this was known as a U.S. Standard Light Pacific. Okay, and this was from 1919. And it was one of the train cars from the ACL, Atlantic Coast Line Railroad, back in the early 1900s. About 1920, 2 series of locomotives began north-southbound routes. The 1200 series was bought for speed for passenger service. And I think, Lee, if we'll go to the next picture, this might be a little better. There you go. It's a little, still a little dark, but this was the 1200 series from around 1920 to 1930. And these were built for power to pull large trains, freight trains, and so forth. It says the railroad lived the golden age of the steam locomotive because of the 1800 series from 1938 to 1948. And Lee, the next picture there, I believe is one of the 1800 series. There you go, there's the 1800 series. These pictures are a little, have a little lighter dark, a little lighter background, a little bit better. Oh, we got a call, let's get this call. Hello, caller, you on the air?
All right, that picture you just showed just before the one that's there right now looks like in the background over the top of that locomotive with those two water tanks down there near where Nashville Road dead ends against the main gate of the Rocky Mount Emerson Shops.
You know, I had to go back and lead to that prior picture, picture number four. I hadn't even noticed that, but right there, you're talking about that picture right there. Is that up on your screen now, Eric?
It's not got right there.
Uh-huh.
But those two, what looks like the crowns on those water tanks, were probably those two wooden water tanks that were down there, right there just north of where Nashville Road dead ended there, going into the Emerson Shops right there where the wholesale grocery business is now.
Gotcha. Adams Wholesale.
That might be a picture of the Atlantic coastline. It is not at Rocky Mount. I know at one time there was a coaling tower there where it was a, like a bucket elevator. Now, I've never seen that picture you're looking at right now, but I know in the early 60s there was two wooden water overhead water tanks right there.
That very well could be it. I hadn't even noticed that.
Where did that picture come from?
This was from the Evening Telegram. I found several pictures dating from the 1920s, 30s, 40s. This was this 1200 series locomotive, as you see there, it was from 1920 and 30s.
All right,
buddy. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
All righty. Okay, so let's go back, Lee, to picture number five. As I said, that this is the 1800 series, and like I said, it was one of the first 100-mile-an-hour locomotives. This thing had the raw power to pull a large number of cars and get them down the track in a hurry. So that was kind of one of the earlier modern-age locomotives there. And it says the 1800 engine was the last type of steam locomotive bought by the coastline. The 1800 engines by Baldwin Locomotive Works was capable of pulling 20 passenger cars at 100 miles an hour, and it fulfilled all expectations for fast passenger service. After 1948, the diesel engine replaced the steam locomotive, and the era of streamliners began. Streamliners. Okay, Lee, all right, so let's go to the next picture then. We should be at number six now. Okay, this to me was a neat picture because, as you'll see in a little bit when we get to these pictures of the little general, this picture here is from 1855, and the caption at the bottom says, here's a picture which is seldom seen these days, that of an old steam locomotive, yet this engine, now keep in mind, I should have said this from the beginning, this is from March the 4th of 1955. So in 1955, and by the way, this is the Rocky Mount Telegram where this picture came from here, and I go on to read the caption, it says, this engine makes daily runs from Tarboro to Farmville on the East Carolina Railroad. The engine on loan by the ACL, which has diesels on its runs now, comes into Rocky Mount once a month for a general checkup. And like I said, this is March of 1955, and this old steam locomotive was pulling into Rocky Mount on its monthly checkup run to get checked out over here at the Emerson Shops. So even though the steam locomotive itself was phased out in the 40s, the guys over at Emerson Shops were still working on at least one of them once a month, giving it a routine monthly checkup. So I thought it was interesting. Okay, let's see, Lee, that was number six. Okay, let's go to number seven, because this is one that we showed last week, and I wanted to bring it up again. I think it was Eric that called in last week and mentioned that this picture here, this, by the way, this is from the Gallopade in 1939. I put it back in this week's series of pictures because we're talking about the railroad number one and number two. Eric mentioned that this is one of the few pictures he's seen that shows what appears to be three sets of tracks downtown Rocky Mount. Now, we've talked about this before on prior shows, where certainly down on the southern end, down near the train depot down there, there was a sidetrack down there, and there was a name for it. Name escaped me at the moment, but basically for temporary use or whatever, turn cars around and so forth. But if you notice, there's Planner's Bank there on your left. So this is kind of a northwest-looking view on the east side of the railroad tracks. And it does appear that there are three sets of tracks there. So I'm guessing that this third set of tracks didn't go very much further than this, if it did at all. It may stop right here at the end of this picture on the right-hand side of your screen there. But I just thought it was neat, and I had not noticed that until Eric brought it to my attention after last week's show, that this one of the few pictures that we've seen that shows that third track downtown Rocky Mount there going right through Main Street down there. So, okay. I tell you what, Lee, I think this is probably a good place to take our first commercial break. So bring it back to me. First, when we come back from the break, we're going to talk a little bit more about trains and the impact of trains on Rocky Mount. And then we're going to jump into some really neat history about the Little General. And I think you'll be really fascinated about what we uncovered about that. So don't go anywhere. We'll be right back with more Wayback Wednesday.
Wednesday, sponsored by Flora's Glass and Mirror Company. Servicing the area since 1977 with residential and commercial work.
I'm Daniel Moss, owner of Cornerstone Funeral Home, and I'd like to invite you and your family to give our family an opportunity to serve you in your time of need. And we offer a full line of funeral services, everything from visitations to graveside services to cremations on site with a live crematory, as well as a banquet hall to meet the catering needs of our families that we serve. We offer catering service, we offer refreshments prior to visitations and services of our family, and we want to invite you to come and experience the difference here at Cornerstone Funeral Home.
When faced with special care needs for elderly or disabled loved ones, families want compassionate, comforting care. That's Tender Touch Home Care Services' goal, providing the level of care we would expect for our own. With over 10 years of home care excellence, Tender Touch provides an array of services that keeps your loved one at home. From personal care, light housekeeping, errands, and meal preparation, to our private duty care program, which combines all of our home care offerings in one package.
Tender Touch Home Care Services, where your needs are our concern.
Hello, I'm Gus Tullis with Gus Tullis Insurance, and I'm here to talk to you about the extended open enrollment period for the Affordable Care Act, better known as Obamacare. Enrollment is available to anyone under age 65. Pre-existing conditions will not disqualify you, and I'm here to inform you of the subsidy that can be available to you based on your household income. You may not even be aware of the potential to improve your current subsidy. You need to take action because the benefits are available if you enroll between now and the August 15th deadline. Now I'd like to take a moment and share with you the annual household income chart. For example, this income chart shows a household of one earning a minimum annual income of $12,760 up to $51,040 and possibly more would qualify for a subsidy. Over the last 3 days, I've helped several folks qualify and sign up for the Obamacare plan. This could be you. To find out if you qualify for a general subsidy, call Gus Tullis Insurance at 252-937-6913. Your subsidy is waiting, but the August 15th deadline is fast approaching. Call me today, 252-937-6913.
You're now watching Wayback Wednesday, sponsored by Flora's Glass and Mirror Company, servicing the area since 1977 with residential and commercial work.
We're back. Folks, if you're just tuning in, you're watching Wayback Wednesday. I'm Randy Adcock. So glad you could join us tonight. Tonight's topic is trains. And you know, at the top of the show, I was mentioning We had a caller last week that I had actually bumped into in a restaurant here locally, and he had mentioned to me about, he said, I want you to mention on your show, if anyone remembers, when the little general came to Rocky Mount. And my first thought was talking about a military officer, and so he went on to explain to me about this Civil War era locomotive that came to Rocky Mount. And so I was intrigued by that idea, number one, that a Civil War era locomotive had visited us. But I wanted to see if I could find a picture. That was my main objective in digging. So I went in search of pictures or references to a visit by the Little General, as it was known, here in Rocky Mount. And as I said earlier, I didn't find any pictures or any reference at all, in fact, of the actual Little General locomotive visiting here. But I uncovered a lot of neat information, and we'll get into that in just a minute. We're going to show you, in fact, an old silent movie video clip. It's a short one, so don't worry, it won't bore you to death, but it's kind of neat. And we're going to show a little clip of an old tune that is attributed to the Little General locomotive. So we'll get to that in just a minute. But first, you know, as a kid, one of my fondest memories, and I was not really big into the newspaper as a kid, don't get me wrong, but every now and again, there would be something in the Rocky Mount Telegram or the Evening Telegram that really caught my attention. And one of the segments was the Junior Editor's Quiz. Some of you may remember this. I think it was only on Sunday, but in any case, it was geared specifically toward kids, and there was always a topic, and they would go into some detail explaining and make put it on a kid's level so kids could understand. And I just thought it was neat that in an adult newspaper, they would make an effort to reach out to the kids and put an article there or something that the kids would find appealing. And so when I stumbled across this article in the Junior Editor's Quiz section of the paper from 1966, I couldn't help but smile. So Lee, if you would, put the next picture up. And this is, it's going to be kind of tough to see on your screen. I apologize again. These are not the greatest. There you go. And I printed off a copy that I have one in my hand here so I can kind of give you an overview of what it's saying. Basically, it says locomotives, of course, is the headline at the top. At the very top left-hand corner, there's an 1804 steam locomotive, which is item number one. Item number two is an 1829 steam locomotive. Item number three is 1850s, roughly, steam locomotive. Item four is probably a little later, maybe 1940s. And then number five, and keep in mind, this is 1960. There you go. It looks better when you zoom in. Thank you, Lee. Number five says the present, and of course, again, this is 1966. So in 1966, here you have one of the streamliners. And then the question is, what is the history of the locomotive? So it's a couple of paragraphs. I'll read this to you right quick here. It says the first practical steam engine was patented in 1698, but it was not until 1804 that Englishman Richard Riventhick successfully operated the Newcastle, which he had designed and which was the first self-propelled steam locomotive. In 1829, another Englishman, George Stephenson, built a much more successful Rocket. Also in 1829, the Sourbridge Lion, built in England, was shipped to and operated in America. The locomotives then developed rapidly. Pistons were placed on the sides in front with heavy connecting rods moving to large driving wheels. A good example of this arrangement was the General. So item number three, if you scroll back up, Lee, item number three is actually a picture of the General, black and white drawing, obviously, but they made a reference specifically to the General in 1966 when they were giving this kid's explanation about locomotives. So that little drawing you see there is supposed to be representative, and I'll show you in a minute a picture of the General, and it does look very much like this image right here. But it says a good example of this was the General of the Civil War period. Later steam locomotives, as in item number four, exhibited the same principles but had more driving wheels. The whole shape was streamlined to lessen wind resistance. In the late 1800s, and electric locomotives began to appear with power from outside. Nowadays, locomotives generating their own electric power use... Oh, we got a call. Oh, let's see here. Hello, caller, you on the air?
Oh, good evening. Good evening. Watching your show and enjoying it.
Thank you.
And I just wanted to mention the fact that locomotive is a English word meaning self movable.
Okay.
So it happened in England. It was the first time that anything could move itself with steam power. Thank you now.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Appreciate that. All righty. Yep, gentlemen, exactly right. As I said, the first practical steam engine was patented in 1698, but it was not until 1804 that an Englishman named Richard, it looks like it's Rivethick, I might have mispronounced it earlier, but he successfully operated the Newcastle, which is that top left picture we showed earlier. So anyway, in 1966, the Rocky Mount Telegram, and this little article designed specifically for the children's market, or not market, but audience, I should say, in their explanation about the history of trains, actually had a picture of the little general there. So, all right now, the little general itself was actually, had quite a fascinating history. In fact, not only was it in the Civil War, it almost created another Civil War many years later. I'll get to that in a minute. But Lee, let's go to the next picture, if you would. And this picture here is one of a little better quality picture. Zoom out on it. There you go. Here we have the general. And this is a much better, it's obviously black and white. And this is from 1855 when the general was built. You'll notice the three on the side there. On the front there. And on the side of it, it's hard to tell in this picture, but the words general was actually in a placard on the side of the engine there. So anyway, I wanted to read a little article here that I found. This was actually from 1912, and this appeared in the Evening Star newspaper, and this was actually out of Kentucky, I believe it was. But anyway, it says, one of the most thrilling incidents of the Civil War was that in which the old engine, the Texas, now keep in mind it's a separate engine, the Texas played so important a part. William J. Knight, an engineer who served as a private in Company E of the 21st Ohio Infantry, was selected by his captain, L.E. Brewster, to attempt to steal a Confederate train which was being hauled by the famous locomotive, the General. James J. Andrews, the famous Kentucky scout and raider, was chosen as a fireman. Their company was encamped at Shelbyville, Tennessee. After reconnoitering, they clambered on the engine while the crew was absent at breakfast, uncoupled a few of the cars in order they might make the best time possible, opened up the throttle, and steamed away. The Confederates soon learned of the disappearance of the train, and suspecting a Union plot, started in pursuit. At Edersville, where Knight was obliged to sidetrack to permit a freight train to pass, the pursuers came into sight. Captain Fuller was in charge of the Confederate party. At Edersville, he abandoned his locomotive, and the Texas was used in its place. With sparks flying from its drivers, the Texas gradually drew up, and the Knight and Andrews, having used all the fuel in the tender, were obliged to abandon the general. They were captured and later escaped from the Atlanta prison. The Texas is now resting peacefully in San Antonio, Texas. So, in a nutshell, what happened was the Union troops made an effort to steal this Confederate train. And in fact, they did steal it. They stole it and took off down the tracks with it. But for a number of reasons, they were forced to abandon their endeavor. And even though it didn't say so in this article, some of those Union troops were actually hanged for stealing a train. So anyway, let's go to the next picture then. And this next picture here is actually kind of a move forward a little bit. And this talks about, this is actually a movie poster from 1926. Buster Keaton, as many of you know, was a silent film star. And he produced and starred in his own movie called The General. Now, it was loosely, and I say loosely, loosely based on the story behind the capture, if you will, and stealing of the general by the Union troops. Buster plays the part of the hero. He's the Confederate hero in the movie. And so anyway, this was, again, from 1926. This was a silent movie called The General. And Lee, if you would, I think this is a very short clip, so only about a minute and a half. But go ahead and gear it up, and you can start it anytime you want to, Lee, and I'll stop talking when you start playing it. But this was one of the most expensive movies ever made at that time. I think there was something like four trains that he had acquired and purchased in order to make this movie. And you'll see why it took so many trains here in a minute when the scene actually starts. But and of course, this was a silent movie. Now, I found this clip online, and someone had graciously put some background music to it. So in 1926, the music you're hearing now did not appear with this film. It was indeed a silent movie, and it had the little captions down below, and you'll see that in a minute as well. But the movie itself, as I said, was loosely based on the story of the general. It's not exactly the same story, but it made a neat movie, and Buster Keaton was, as I said, the producer and starred in his own movie. And back in 1926, it was a box office hit. So, are we ready, Lee?
Yeah.
All right, let her roll. That. I don't know how many Buster Keaton fans we have, but anyway, that was Buster Keaton in 1926 in the movie The General, loosely based on the story of The General. So, as I said, The General actually was in the Civil War, actually participated, obviously, and it almost caused another Civil War many, many years later. We'll get to that in just a second. But it actually now resides in a museum, thank goodness. It's saved and it's in a museum. So the train that went over the trestle there into the river was not the General. As I said, there was, I think I read somewhere where Buster Keaton had purchased three or four trains just to make that scene and shot it multiple times. So anyway, all right, let's go to the next picture then, because this takes us a little bit later, 1942. In 1942, America was engaged in World War II. Oh, you know what? I forgot we got this. This is actually, and you know what, Lee? I may be at, is that item number 12 you just pulled up there on the screen, or was that 13?
That's 13.
Let's go to 12. I think number 12 is the one I was had in mind. There we go. Again, it's a little bit grainy, a little bit fuzzy, but this is from October 27th of 1942. And I'm going to read the caption because I know it's a little hard for you to see. This is actually a picture of the general you're looking at right there. And it says, if it becomes necessary to throw the general, Chattanooga's most famous Civil War locomotive, on the scrap pile in order to win the war with the Axis, the general will be scrapped. Frank T. Herron, Hamilton County Salvage Chairman, said yesterday. However, Mr. Herron expressed hope that this will not be necessary. Francis C. Walton, above, chairman of the Scrap Metal Committee, stands beside a scrap barrel that has been set up alongside the General in Union Station. And you see the sign says, Save the General, put your scrap metal here. And so in 1942, when the World War II was going on, there was obviously all the metal that could be scraped up was going into the war effort, building planes and trains and buses, not buses, but airplanes and tanks, and of course guns and bullets and everything else needed to fight a war. So the General not being able to be used anymore as a practical means of transportation was very close to being scrapped. In fact, it did not, but it was very close to having met a very serious demise by being put to the scrap metal pile. So thank goodness it did not. But again, at 1942. So, okay, now Lee, the next is a video that I just thought was kind of fun, and it's Glenn Miller did a version of a song we probably all heard. If you haven't, you'll hear it here in a minute, and it was referred to as a Chattanooga Choo Choo. And the Chattanooga Choo Choo was actually based on the General, because for a long time the General was stored in Chattanooga, Tennessee. And so Lee, if you want to take a break, and when we come out from break we'll play the video then. Does that work for you?
Yeah.
All right. Let's take a quick commercial break. When we come back, we're not going to play the whole thing. It's kind of a long video, but I found it, and it's neat. We had a last week's show was all about orchestras and so forth, and so I found this really neat video of Glenn Miller and his orchestra playing Chattanooga Choo Choo. So when we come back from the break, we'll share a little bit of that with you. So don't go anywhere. We'll be right back with more Wayback Wednesday.
You're now watching Wayback Wednesday, sponsored by Flora's Glass and Mirror Company, servicing the area since 1977 with residential and commercial work.
Hello, I'm Gus Tullis with Gus Tullis Insurance, and I'm here to talk to you about the extended open enrollment period for the Affordable Care Act, better known as Obamacare. Enrollment is available to anyone under age 65. Pre-existing conditions would not disqualify you, and I'm here to inform you of the subsidy that can be available to you based on your household income. You may not even be aware of the potential to improve your current subsidy. You need to take action because the benefits are available if you enroll between now and the August 15th deadline. Now I'd like to take a moment and share with you the annual household income chart. For example, this income chart shows a household of one earning a minimum annual income of $12,760 up to $51,040 and possibly more would qualify for a subsidy. Over the last 3 days, I've helped several folks qualify and sign up for the Obamacare plan. This could be you. To find out if you qualify for a general subsidy, call Gus Tullis Insurance at 252-937-6913. Your subsidy is waiting, but the August 15th deadline is fast approaching. Call me today, 252-937-6913.
I'm Daniel Moss, owner of Cornerstone Funeral Home, and I'd like to invite you and your family to give our family an opportunity to serve you in your time of need. And we offer a full line of funeral services, everything from visitations to graveside services to cremations on site with a live crematory, as well as a banquet hall to meet the catering needs of our families that we serve. We offer catering service. We offer refreshments prior to visitations and services of our family. And we want to invite you to come and experience the difference here at Cornerstone Funeral Home.
When faced with special care needs for elderly or disabled loved ones, families want compassionate, comforting care. That's Tender Touch Home Care Services' goal, providing the level of care we would expect for our own. With over 10 years of home care excellence, Tender Touch provides an array of services that keeps your loved one at home. From personal care, light housekeeping, errands, and meal preparation, to our private duty care program, which combines all of our home care offerings in one package.
Tender Touch Home Care Services, where your needs are our concern.
You're now watching Wayback Wednesday, sponsored by Flora's Glass and Mirror Company, servicing the area since 1977 with residential and commercial work.
And we're back. Before the break, I mentioned that we had a little clip to share with you. I ran across an article that made a reference to the fact that the Chattanooga Choo Choo song from the 1930s and 40s was basically a tribute, if you will, to the Little General. For many years, the Little General was actually on display there in Chattanooga. And later years, it moved, and I'll get into that in just a minute. But I thought it was neat. I actually pulled up this little video on YouTube, and I actually captured a little bit of it. So, Leif, whenever you're ready, go ahead and fire it up, and just give us, maybe a minute and a half of it. It's a rather long video, but I just want folks to kind of, those who may not be familiar with the song Chattanooga Choo Choo, it's a neat video of Glenn Miller's orchestra and his version of the song Chattanooga Choo Choo. So take it away, Leif, whenever you're ready.
Chattanooga Choo Choo, run it down again. Let's go. One.
No, singing in that, but I found the lyrics, and some of you may remember these lyrics. I'm not going to try to sing it, don't worry, because I can't sing, but I will read a little bit of it. It starts off, "Pardon me, boy, is that the Chattanooga choo-choo? Track 29, boy, you can give me a shine. I can afford to board a Chattanooga choo-choo. I've got my fare, and just a trifle to spare. You leave the Pennsylvania station about a quarter to four, read a magazine, and you're in Baltimore." But yeah, I never knew that song was actually based or generated because of a train that was actually a real train, but certainly, apparently it was, and so I thought it was neat. Okay, so I mentioned earlier that the Little General was in the Civil War, and it almost caused another Civil War. And I thought, that, you know, and by the way, let me back up just a minute. When I showed that clip, I should have mentioned this earlier, the clip of Buster Keaton in his movie, that was a comedy, by the way, if you couldn't tell, it was a comedy. And in 1926, comedies were pretty popular, obviously, always have been for that matter. But it was just, I would love to see the whole thing. I don't know how long that movie lasts, probably no more than 30 minutes at the most. But I may try to see if I can find it somewhere and watch the whole thing, because when he's got the fire going in, he tries to jump over the fire and jump on the train, and obviously the other side of the fire is a burnout spot in the track, and he falls through it into the river. That was all, and I don't know if he did his own stunts or not, but wouldn't surprise me if he didn't in 1926. So anyway, I tell you what, let's do, Lee. Let's go ahead and jump back in our pictures. In 1959, I think we're at picture number 14 now. There you go. The caption on this picture here, and by the way, this is from Chattanooga, and it says, "This famed Civil War locomotive, the General, stands in Union Station in Chattanooga as a verbal battle rages between Georgia and Tennessee over its future display. The fence was erected recently to thwart souvenir hunters." Now, this was in 1959. So what happened was, Both Georgia and Tennessee claimed ownership to this train. When it was captured in Tennessee, in Georgia, and so Georgia said it was theirs. In any case, Tennessee wanted it. They had it for a number of years, and then there was, and we'll get to the theft of the train in a minute, because it was actually stolen, believe it or not. Someone stole the little general. And but before we get to that, I found this neat article here from 1962. And this was when the general actually was on its little tour around the country. And this was the tail end of it. I'm not sure when the tour started or how long it lasted. And if it did, in fact, visit Rocky Mount, it was probably during this tour in 1962, thereabouts. Because in 1962, this headline, and Lee, you can go ahead and pull up the next picture. It's just a picture of the article I'm about to read. I'm not going to read the whole thing. But it's a headline, Mission for the General. And it says, time has slowed the general to a walk, but the ancient wood burner retained enough pep to complete its latest mission just barely. The star of the Civil War's great locomotive chase toot-tooted into town Thursday to take part in a ceremonious commemorative creation of the Medal of Honor. It ran smack into a skirmish with a section of District of Columbia Railroad tracks. The general is now 107 years old. Now keep in mind, this article was written in 1962. It's much older than that now. It says the general is now 107 years old and its joints have stiffened, but it started out jauntily enough on a 1.5 mile run to Navy Yard, tooting its whistle, belching black smoke and fiercely hissing steam. An hour and a half later, the general arrived. Average speed, 1 mile per hour. In the interim, the passenger car loaded down with newsmen, dignitaries, and Civil War buffs was lost, and a second load of dignitaries waiting at the Naval Yard had their fill of the hot sun. The curves were just too much for the general's joints, but some railroad fans said it was a tribute to the old engine that had reached its destination at all. Part of the credit, too, should go to W. Alvin Gaines, manager of equipment for the Louisville and Nashville Railroad, which owns and keeps the general. Decked out in a stovepipe hat and gray frock coat, Gaines of Louisville, Kentucky, walked alongside the engine, armed with a big oil can. He oiled guardrails and signaled the engineer to back off a bit and then inch forward. The whole purpose of this was to commemorate the creation of the Medal of Honor. For those that weren't aware, the Medal of Honor was first awarded during the Civil War. In fact, of the Union troops who stole the general back in 1862, I think it was, six of those survivors received medals of honor for their participation in the effort to steal the general in the Civil War. So, neat article there about the general, little history for you about the general. So, fast forward there, that was in 1962. Fast forward 5 years to 1967, I think it is, Lee. Oh, well, before we get to that, let's go to the next picture, because we've got a couple pictures here that I think, there you go. This was actually the crowd that met the little general when it reached Tennessee, Chattanooga, Tennessee in 1959. I should have showed this first, actually, but anyway, as you can see, there were throngs of people that showed up, and that's one of the better pictures that I had, was able to find of the little general itself. And it appears to have one car behind it, just for show, I'm sure. The next picture, Lee, if you would, let's go ahead and show that next one. And this is actually the article that I wanted to tell you about. The Chattanooga captures Civil War locomotive. And it says, Chattanooga official, supported by a spotter plane, staged a daring raid. And by the way, this is September 1967. Staged a daring raid yesterday and sidetracked a famous Civil War locomotive being transported from Louisville to Kennesaw, Georgia. The locomotive, the General, was the object of the great locomotive chase of 1862 from Kennesaw to Ringgold, Georgia. And it goes on to tell about how the Union Army raiders, disguised as civilians, seized the engine from the Confederate troops. After a hectic 87-mile chase, the General ran out of fuel and was recaptured. But anyway, what happened was the mayor and two or three dignitaries from Chattanooga intercepted this train as it was being transported from one part of the country, to another part of the country, and they actually stole the train. And so, anyway, a bitter battle, you know, certainly among dignitaries, as much of a battle as dignitaries can engage in. There were no fist fights or anything, I don't think. But anyway, there was a war of words, I guess a better way to say it, between Chattanooga and Kennesaw, Georgia, for a number of years. The next picture, if you would, Lee, let's go ahead and go to that one. And the Georgia, of course, filed a lawsuit against Tennessee, Chattanooga, and said, bring our train back. And Tennessee basically said, you know, go pound sand, it's our train, we got it, we stole it, it's ours now. And so anyway, there's a little article here, I'm going to read the whole thing. It says, Georgia officials said Tuesday they have filed a suit in federal district court in Chattanooga, Tennessee, to force that city to give up the famed Civil War locomotive, the General. The engine was seized by city officials September 12th, this is in 1967, by the way, in a pre-dawn raid as it was rolling through Chattanooga to go to a museum in Kennesaw, Georgia. The locomotive, unofficial city seal of Chattanooga, was first hijacked in 1862 by Union Army forces. Georgia Confederate soldiers recaptured it after a hot chase, blah, blah, blah. So anyway, in 1967, the general is stolen by dignitaries from Tennessee, brought to Tennessee. Georgia files a lawsuit that we want our train back. Give us our train back. The next picture, Lee, if you will, let's go ahead and show this next picture. This is this may have all been for publicity. I don't know, honestly. I don't remember hearing anything about this. But this is a picture. It says, Chattanooga officials. By the way, this is from September 1967. Says, Chattanooga officials with Mayor Ralph Kelly in the cab are staying close to famed Civil War locomotive, the General, after they sidetracked the train bound from Louisville to Tennessee, Georgia. So again, the mayor was in on this, and this could have all been a highly organized plot to draw some attention to both cities, I don't know. But the fact that Georgia filed a lawsuit makes me think at least there was some upset people in Georgia anyway about this. So they filed a lawsuit. Finally, let's go to the next picture. This was actually, I think this next one, this was in 1969. The feud was still going on. They still couldn't decide who should rightfully have the Chattanooga, I mean, I'm sorry, the little general. And so going to the next picture, and in 1960, let's see,1972, the general finally made its way back to Kennesaw, Georgia. And this gentleman here guarding it with his musket and all dressed out in his Civil War garb is named Robert E. Lee Gray, believe it or not, his real name. He's a Kennesaw Mountain volunteer. He's guarding the general, the little Civil War locomotive that has been the focus of a five-year legal battle for possession between Georgia and Tennessee. So Georgia got it back. They got their little general back. And Lee, the next picture, I believe, you would go ahead and bring that up for us. There you go. This is at the museum. It's called the Museum of Civil War and Locomotive History in Kennesaw, Georgia. And this is the actual little general locomotive featured in movie and song and almost a reason for a second Civil War in this country in 1967. I'd love to go there. This looks to be a neat place. They've got trains and they've got a lot of memorabilia from the Civil War era. One of the most decisive battles of the war took place during the time all this was going on. And so that was one reason that trains were being hijacked and stolen, and because they were obviously used to ferry supplies and weapons and personnel all over the country. Certainly the trains were vital to the war effort, so if you could stop a few trains, blow up a few train tracks, and stop troop movement going around, you had a better chance of winning the war, and obviously the Union troops did. So anyway, Lee, I think, let's go ahead. I think we got time maybe for one or two more. We'll go through these. This is actually, and this is totally off the subject here, but the reason I've included this, and Lee, I don't know if you can zoom in on this or not, but this is from the Firestone, and this ad appeared in 1968, I think it was. I'm sorry, 1942. I was looking at two pictures and had my eyes got crossed there. 1942, this picture was in, and this was, by the way, when the Firestone was down on Church Street, a block or so up from where Central Cafe is now. In a previous show, we talked about the Firestone store being down there. I think there's a funeral home or something in it now. But in any case, there's some neat toys that live here. And there was actually a couple things that caught my eye. There was a train all on the right-hand side just below that set of Army Builder set there. I had a set of those, by the way. But anyway, and trains were certainly popular toys for little boys and little girls too, I suppose, for some anyway. From the 40s, you know, again, this was from 1942, so World War II was going on, and so tanks and planes and things that little kids could pretend anyway to participate in the war effort were hot ticket items, and that ad appeared in December of 1942. Folks, that's about going to wrap it up for us tonight. We didn't get to all the pictures I wanted to show you. We did get to all the ones that covered the little general. Lee, bring it back to me if you would. I've had a few more ads I wanted to share with you. We'll try to get those in next week. Folks, thank you so much for tuning in tonight. I appreciate the calls and all your viewers. It means more to me than you know. So thanks again for participating in the show. Have yourselves a great week, folks. Take care of each other and be kind to each other. And we'll see you next week with more Wayback Wednesday. Good night.
You're now watching Wayback Wednesday, sponsored by Flores Glass and Mirror Company, servicing the area since 1977 with residential and commercial work.
I'm Daniel Moss, owner of Cornerstone Funeral Home, and I'd like to invite you and your family to give our family an opportunity to serve you in your time of need. And we offer a full line of funeral services, everything from visitations to graveside services to cremations on site with a live crematory, as well as a banquet hall to meet the catering needs of our families that we serve. We offer catering service, we offer refreshments prior to visitations and services of our family, and we want to invite you to come and experience the difference here at Cornerstone Funeral Home.